deliberative session to order. Can everyone hear me?
No.
No? All right.
You've got to turn up the ball.
I want to get feet. Is this better? It's probably a little too. Oscar Leach and Will Anderson. One is a member of the Summerswick Middle School, and one is a member of the 6th Grade Student Council here at Rollinsford Grade School, to lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance.
Introduction, so we all know who we are around sort of the outside of the room. Seated at the front is the school board. My seat at the end, I'm the chair, Judy Nelson at the end. Next is Alan Robinson, he's our representative to the Budget Committee. Emily Leach, Andrea Anderson, and Tom Coons. Moving over here to my right, your left, we have our administrators, Kate Lucas, principal of Rollinsford Grade School, Superintendent Jenny Mosca. Our council for today, we always have council with us at these meetings, Anthony Muir, our business administrator out of the SAU office, Marie D'Agostino, and our special ed coordinator, director, Pam McDonald. And then, most of you know, the budget committee seated over there on the right, and then swinging all the way over to the left. We would like to thank Corey Jones for stepping into the school district clerk position at sort of short notice. We really appreciate him stepping up and doing that. So those are the introductions out of the way. Again, I'd like to thank you all for being here. We're here today to deliberate all of the budget or warrant articles for the school district. Preparing and presenting a budget is one of the most important functions the school board does. It's a big responsibility, and we do put quite a bit of time and effort into doing that. A few years ago, some of you may remember, we really looked at that mission and decided we want to really dig down deep into budgets, and we wanted to start presenting to you budgets that showed savings, that we were really looking for savings if we could find them. And we have. This will be the second year in a row that we are presenting a lower operating cost at Rollinsford Grade School. Some of you have heard me say this many times, but Rollinsford Grade School is really the only place where we have control over how the money is spent. All of the rest of our money is spent on contractual obligations. But again, this is the second year in a row that we are presenting significant savings in Rollinsford Grade School. One of the other things we said a few years ago was that we would then try to reinvest those savings back into Rollinsford Grade School. So what you're going to see today is a complete budget that does both of those things, saves money and also reinvests it back in. So the things to keep in mind as we start to deliberate today are, these warrants are the result of hours and hours and hours of hard work on the part of our board members and of all of our administrators. We believe in sustainable, responsible budgeting. 2 years ago, we said we'd like your support as we work through the next few years, figuring out how best to do all that, and how to best implement some of the best things that we're doing. And so, again, we're continuing to ask for your support. We had a 3 to 4 year arc, and this is the second year of that arc. And again, this is our second budget after making those statements a few years ago that we are delivering a real Rollinsford Grade School savings to the town. So, thank you.
Thank you. the business before us, but I want to share a few words about the moderator's rules, because this is a deliberative session. It's a little bit different from other kinds of town meetings. There are a couple of copies of the moderator's rules floating around in the room, and if you ever have questions about them, don't hesitate to look for one of those copies or to pose a question to me about them. One of the things about moderator's rules is that this is a legislative body. Each and every voter who's here today is a legislator for the town of Rollinsford. And as legislators, any ruling that I make as a moderator, you can overrule by a majority vote. So if you are displeased with anything that I do as your moderator, you're always entitled to overrule me by a majority vote. Under RSA 40:13, this is what we call an SB2 town. This is a legislative session that we're here, but the law limits what we can do at this session. So we've already referred to warrant articles. Those warrant articles will get voted on at the town elections on Tuesday, March 14th. So what we do here today in the deliberative session is to discuss and debate those warrant articles. We can ask for information about the warrant articles. We can amend the warrant articles, or at least some of those warrant articles, within limits that are prescribed for us by the law. The school district has an attorney here present to help me rule on what amendments are or are not within the scope of what the law allows. For now, just I think you can assume as a legislator that many of the articles before you can be amended if need be, you'll get we'll talk further if you propose an amendment. If you want to ask for information, please just come to the front mic. To address the body, please just line up at the front mic. You don't have to wait for the previous speaker to finish. Please begin so that the town, so the school district clerk can get accurate minutes of the meeting. Please begin by stating your name and street address, and I'll recognize people at the microphone. As we introduce warrant articles, I'm going to allow the school board to introduce the article. I will not read the warrant article in full. If in introducing the article to you, they want to read it in full, I will do that. But given that we have nearly universal literacy in the town of Rollinsford, I'm not going to read it for you in the interest of time. I'm also going to freely recognize Mr. Crozier, who is the chair of the budget committee. There are just a couple of articles where the school board has offered one position and the budget committee has offered another. I think as legislators of the town of Rollinsford, it's important for you to have the perspective of both bodies as those warrant articles come up. If you want information about a warrant article, again, this is a good opportunity to become more further informed about the matters that we'll all be voting on at the town elections in March. Just look at me and say, Mr. Moderator, I'd like to know X. And then I'll look to Ms. Nelson or Mr. Crozier and ask them to respond to the question. What I'm going to ask you to avoid doing is please don't follow up directly by looking at the school board member or the budget committee member and asking a further question. Please direct your request for information through me. On amendments, if you want to amend a warrant article, there are pieces of paper back with the supervisors of the checklist. They're waving their hand for us. Blank pieces of paper, please write the amendment down. It's very important that it be written down so that as an older person now, my hearing is not as good as I would like it to be any longer. So I don't mistake what it is that you want to say in the amendment. So you have a chance to think through carefully how you want to amend the warrant article, and so that the school district clerk has a very clear record, because ultimately what happens on March 14th is the decisions that we make about putting the warrant articles forward to the town at this deliberative session need to be clearly reflected on that ballot. So we need to have it written down. Finally, I hope you enjoyed today's meeting. I hope that you walk away feeling that your time was well spent. Living in a democracy does not require us to agree about any particular article or amendment. As we discuss and debate articles and amendments, however, Let's try to remember that the school board and the budget committee are made up of dedicated volunteers, that people who express disagreement with warrant articles share a sincere belief in the value of public education, and that every voter is given the right to express his or her views on an issue, and that we will continue after today's meeting, after the town elections, to be neighbors in a remarkable town. Any questions about the moderator's rules? Articles 1 through 4, there is no discussion to be had on those articles. The nominations have been closed, and those articles will appear on the ballot at town election as printed in the warrant. Article 5 is the school district budget, and I believe that Mr. Robinson from the school board will introduce that warrant article for us.
Hello, everybody. So, we're just going to pull up our presentation here so everybody can see what we're talking about as we move forward. I might just help out for just a second. We're looking for the view. I have no idea where slideshow is.
All the way over to the right on the top under where it says perfect. Yeah.
Right there. Presenter view. That's the one.
Oh, look at that. Thank you.
Thank you all.
Wow. That's how I'm trying to be an actor or something. Not quite there. All right. So, thank you, everybody. I'm sorry about that brief interruption. So, anyone who was here for the last meeting knows that my throat was a little scratchy and I was coughing a lot. I apologize. I do have candy today to help me through it. But the idea of today is we're going to go through the Rollinsford Grade School budget. We're going to break it out into a couple different aspects so that way we can show the cost trends and where Judy said a few minutes ago, we were able to save some money at the Rollinsford Grade School, and we're going to show that's trending, and then we'll also show where the increases are in our contractual expenses. So with that, we can get started. And our first slide that we like to show is where the proposed operating budget is and where each of the schools fall. I'm going to get up and see if I can walk over there. Look at that, I think I can get a little closer. So what we have on the screen is, if you look at the top line, that's the total budget. So from, actually we're not showing the years on the slide, but for FY 16, 17, and 18, those were 3 points. So you can see the total operating budget has slowly slid up over the last, we're proposing into the third year. If you look at the next line down, that's your RGS, that's your Rollinsford Grade School, the building we're in here. And what you can see is a slight trend down. Right, so those are the cost savings that that Judy was talking about a few minutes ago. The third line down is our middle and high school expense. And what you can see is that line is actually a little sharper going up, trending up, than the top total operating budget. And the reason is, if you put the two lines together, the Rollinsford Grade School and the middle and high school, right, the grade school brings the line down a little bit and the middle and high school bring it up. Well, the middle and high school, we want to talk about that. I'm going to show another slide later on as we go. That's a contractual obligation. So the town of Rollinsford has decided and voted on that we were going to outsource education for middle and high school. So for every student that goes to middle and high school, we have a set dollar value that we have to pay to the Marshwood School District for those students. The last line on here, the green line down the bottom, is our what we're calling other, but that's our SAU costs and miscellaneous costs that really don't fall in the RGS bucket or the middle and high school contractual obligation bucket. So that line has been fairly steady. It is trending up, and what I would offer on that line is anyone who follows the school board and comes to the meetings and is engaging it through the minutes will know that we're getting a bargain on an SAU cost. And the reason I can comfortably say we're getting a bargain is because we share that cost with the Summersworth School District. We share a district. And the way that cost is figured out is based on enrollment, but it's only enrollment in elementary school. So we, as Rollinsford, really luck out in that that algorithm that figures out the total cost of SAU expenses. So with that, we can go to our next slide and just hang back. I want to show our enrollment trends. So these are important, and we're showing 3 years, and I know that there's some people in town who remember 20, 30 years ago when the numbers were even higher. So no, I'm not going back 30 years on the trend, but I am showing the last 3 years, 16, 17, and projecting out for 18. We project for 18 based on what our enrollment was October 1 of this year, or I guess it was last year now. So October 1 of 16 is how we come up with our FY18 numbers. So the reason I want to show this chart is we've made some significant changes to education in the town of Rollinsford in the last couple of years. One would be that we have outsourced education instead of to Summersworth, but to Marshwood. And second, we've changed how education is offered here at Rollinsford Grade School. We've gone to a co-teaching model. It's a little different than standard teaching. So with that, what we can show is the total enrollment for the district has gone from 291 up to 326. So that's a significant change. For the Rollinsford Grade School, that's your blue line coming down, we've gone from 155 to 165, so a difference of 10 students. At the Rollinsford Grade School, we can absorb those costs into the operating budget pretty easily, right? Because we have to run this school. And to run the school, there's a certain sunk cost that it has. You know, you have to pay the electric bill, you have to pay the oil bill, you have to pay all those things. No matter what, no matter what your number of students are. Now there is a cap. Right? At some point, we might need additional classrooms and additional teachers so we don't go over the size limits, but we're not there. Right? We're within our realm of where we can handle for capacity here at Rollinsford Grade School. But the next line is significant, and this is the line I want to focus on for a second. That's the red line down the bottom that shows our middle and high school enrollment. And what we've done is from FY16, we had 136 students. In FY17, we went to 145.5. And now for FY18, we're looking at 161. All of those students have a cost. And that cost is set in a contract that we, as a town, voted on that we send over to Marshwood. So what the Rollinsford School Board has seen over the last 2 years, since we've started this transition, is that during the year, we consistently see an increase in the students coming into town and being outsourced over to the Marshwood School District. Well, around $10,000 a student adds up fairly quickly when you're looking at adding 5 or 6 students a year to your budget. That's $50,000, $60,000 as you move forward. So it's one of the things we're going to show you today is that we're actually budgeting for the FY18 budget to have a couple of extra students budgeted in so we can absorb those costs a little easier. So with that, we can go on to our next slide, where we're going to talk specifically numbers to Rollinsford Grade School. So we're proposing the budget of $3,067,949, but I'm not going to read all these points, but what I want to show and really hit home on is the change, is the decrease of $309,878. So what Judy said earlier in her introduction was the Rollinsford School Board has pledged to the town that we were implementing a 3 to 4 year plan where we were going to decrease cost at Rollinsford Grade School because that's the one area that's not contractually obligated and we can make a difference. With those savings, we're asking the town through warrant articles to improve the building, to improve the facility. So a few years ago, there was talk of bonding and doing major renovations. There wasn't an appetite for that in town, which is okay. That's when we reprogrammed how we were going to move forward. We were going to reduce the operating cost and increase warrant articles and allow the town the decision and the vote to make maintenance changes and make physical changes to the building. So you'll see some of those today. So how are we able to save money at Rollinsford Grade School? Well, this year there was a staff member who resigned. The school board and the administration decided not to replace that teacher. So that was a decision that was going to be put forward in the FY18 budget. We were actually looking to reduce a teacher, but we were able to realize that a year early, so we were able to see those savings. Second, one of the things I call it a little funny math. It's just the truth of how things work. But the FY17 warrant articles that we put out. So we put out to have the asbestos taken care of in the new part of the building back there. We also had to bring in three-phase power into the main part of the building. So we had some warrant articles that we put out. Well, those come out of the operating budget if they're passed, right? So they get passed, we do the work, and it goes into the operating budget. But when we come back with changes for this year, it shows as a decrease. So that's why that's there, and that's why we can save these numbers are, right? So we also have been able to realize the savings of $15,000 in utilities. Now, one of the things I'd like to point out on that $15,000 is we've made some changes in the school. You can look up and see the light bulbs that are up there. Those are energy efficient light bulbs, right? So when we purchased those light bulbs, we also filled out those little, they used to be PSNH, now they're Eversource rebates, right? So the administration was able to fill out and obtain a whole bunch of rebates to make the school more energy efficient, right? So part of that is having a facilities manager in-house that can do those things, that knows what light bulbs to buy and how to insulate different areas to save that kind of money. So we were able to realize the savings of $15,000. The second is a transportation savings. So I was corrected at the last meeting, and so I'll say it corrected today. That's because we've gone to full-day kindergarten here at Rollinsford Day School, which is, I think, a big advantage from an academics perspective. And so because of that, we're able to save $15,000 because we don't have to do that midday bus run. Last, there's a fund transfers of $50,000. So last year, we asked the town, we're going to ask the town again this year, to put $25,000 into two different accounts. We'll talk about them a little later. One is a special education fund, is what we call it, and the other is a building fund for an emergency building fund. So with that, that is a very broad, high-level look at the Rollinsford Grade School, the savings that we've seen, and we'll talk about it in a little bit, is the warrant articles that we're going to ask the town for this year to realize some of those savings, to come in so that way we can continue some of the maintenance and the building doesn't fall apart on us. So with that, we can go on to the middle and high school. So for the middle and high school, our proposed budget is $735,555. So in this particular screen here, what I want to point out is specifically our increase, the $354,243 increase. So that includes the three contingency students. It also includes the 3% Summersworth increase and the 3.7% Marshwood increase. Those are increases that we voted on as a town when we signed our contract with Marshwood. And Summersworth it's underneath the Marshwood, and the school board was able to make those numbers work. So this increase is not because the Rollinsford School Board has decided that we need to add any additional services in this department. It's because we have an increase in the number of students. So there's not any way for the Rollinsford School Board to adjust this number. That's our contractual number based on the number of students in town that we are outsourcing to Marshwood. So I don't need to get home on that anymore. I don't really need to carry on. So our total budget that we're presenting this year, $5,555,156. So that's an increase of $44,365,000. What I'd like the town to realize is that small increase comes with two different things. First is it comes with a huge savings at the Rollinsford Grade School, which is the very difficult work that the administration and the staff here at the school have done be able to help to keep those costs low and be able to continue the quality of education here at Rollinsford Grade School. And second, the realization that the reason that number isn't a decrease and it's not even lower than it is because of our contractual obligations to continue to provide education to our middle and high school students and the fact that we're outsourcing that education across the country. So with that, we can carry on. And we have to talk about revenues and expenditures and where things go. So this is the way the budget works. The town will receive some state money. It changes every year, and we do our best to estimate where that number will fall. So we're projecting that we're going to see an increase at approximately $92,957, so around $100,000 more than FY17.
So when you look at the way this works, right, you take your expenses and all the stuff we were just talking about, you add in your revenue from the state and the different areas that we get it, and you come out with your net, right? So our net is looking at about 5.5 million, which is about 1% less, or $48,592 less than FY17. So I think that's really a testament of what the school board has been able to do, and really a show to the town that the school board is taking the position of budgeting and the position of saving money in town seriously. So with that, we can, one of the things that we get asked at all of these meetings is enrollment. What does enrollment look like? What do the trends look like? Where are we going to be in the future? Well, I have no idea where we're going to be in the future, but I can provide you what we have and what we think is going to happen. And like I said, the FY18 numbers that we're presenting today are based on a formula, and that formula is October 1st, 2016. So it's not that we're projecting out these numbers, right? The only thing that we projected as a school board was I'll call it the student buffer, the three student buffer that we have going to Marshwood, right? So around $30,000 built in that we did for that. So here what we're showing is RGS K-6. We were looking at 155 at the start of the year, and we're looking at 164 to start FY18. Right? For Marshwood, 7 to 12, we're looking at FY17, 122, and here's our significant change. In FY18, we're looking at 150. Right? So at $10,168.50, that adds up. Summersworth, we do still have a few students attending Summersworth, and you can see here there's 23.5. In FY17, we had a long conversation last year about the 0.5, which is having to do with some funding in towns and different scenarios. But in FY18, we're seeing 11. We should continue to see that number fall. How many more years we got? It'll go to zero after next year, so we're very close. But we did want to show that was out here. Now, you'll see the base tuition is a little higher than the base tuition at Marshwood, and that's all has to do with all of the information that we put out 2 years ago and the votes that we had about sending the students to Marshwood. So with that, that's where our enrollment stands. And Article 5 operating budget, as we talked about, right? What we're bringing forward is a budget that we took seriously, where we're looking to reduce costs where we can. We're looking to plan accordingly for the costs that we can't project very well and that we haven't projected very well. And with that, we've added three additional students so we don't find ourselves hurting for money. Anyone who follows the school board knows that last year, due to some changes and not being sure where the budget was, we actually had to freeze the budget because we weren't sure that we were going to have enough money to fulfill all of our obligations. So you guys might wonder, what does that mean, right? Because we're obligated to pay Marshwood and Summersworth and these contractual items, right? Well, that meant that we stopped buying paper and crayons and pens and all of the other aspects of Rollinsford Grade School. So when we don't have enough money in the budget and we have to make adjustments, Rollinsford Grade School is what gets hit. And so adding those three contingency students is so we don't have to not buy those supplies and we don't have to not buy or go forward with anything. We don't have to shut the lights off with students playing in the gym because we have just enough sunlight coming in through the windows, right? So those are the types of things that the Rollinsford School Board is presenting and coming forward with today. So with that, I believe I'm going to hand it over to Ms. Nelson. I'm actually going to hand it over to her so she can talk about the collective bargaining agreement. All right, yeah, this is why we're supposed to go back to the moderator, right? So back to Mr. Moderator.
This meeting is going to be able to discuss, debate, and amend the budget. Before I open it to the floor, does the budget committee want to make any opening remarks about the budget? No? Okay. We're open for discussion, request for information, debate, proposed amendments on the school district's proposed budget. I don't want to rush anybody. Oh.
I know there's been a lot of debate this year about the activities bus. Is that included and that's been changed for a savings on the school side? Is that reflected in the budget?
We have a question about the activities bus.
Any of you who have joined us at our school board meetings know that we have discussed the activities or late bus that runs from Marshwood pretty much every month for the past 18 months. We reached a final decision just before we put the budget to press, and before we presented it to the budget committee and put it to press, that we would not provide the full service activity bus. But we have not removed the ability for our middle and high school students to take an activity bus and get delivered to the town of Rollinsford. We have left in enough money to provide our middle and high school students to leave either the Marshwood Middle School and the Marshwood High School and be delivered to the Legion after school. So we took out $22,000 but put $5,000 back in to cover that cost.
Thank you. And not to rush it, but to keep our meeting moving smoothly, I find that debate on Article 5, the proposed budget, is over. The budget will be placed on the ballot. Article 6 relates to approving cost items included in the collective bargaining agreement between the Rollinsford School Board and the Rollinsford Education Association. I believe Ms. Nelson from the school committee will introduce the article. And that Mr. Crozier from the Budget Committee will respond.
We're working on getting some slides up. I'm afraid that I may be responsible for some of the technical difficulties that are going on here. Warrant Article 6, which is the collective bargaining agreement between the Rollinsford Education Association and the town, represented by the Rollinsford School Board. This year, I believe, is what I would call sort of an historic agreement has been reached. I can't say enough how impressed I am that the Rollinsford Education Association came in and offered to us, to the town, to take a lower cost health care plan that would save the town $42,000 a year. In other words, taking $42,000 off of our costs, where they will stay off as the years go on, so that as healthcare costs go up, as they seem to do every single year, we will start from that lower base, $42,000 less. This is amazing. These are ongoing savings that are going to take that we will save every single year. At the very bottom, if we just say, if compared to what we're paying today, over the next 3 years, we would save $120,000, just like that, if the costs stayed the same as they were today. If we did not take this agreement and do that. Now, there are increases involved with that. For a number of years, we have not passed collective bargaining agreements here in town. The town has simply decided not to pass the collective bargaining agreement. When that happens, we have teachers who were hired under a STEP program, and a STEP is essentially a way to the way teachers get paid. These are in all teachers' contracts throughout the state and across the nation for their experience. As they become better teachers, as they become experienced teachers throughout the years, and so we have a number of teachers. I believe it's about 6 teachers who are not on their appropriate step. They have fallen behind, in other words. They have worked hard here, they have worked, but they have not been rewarded for their experience and keeping their experience here in Rollinsford Grade School. So the board, on behalf of the town, has agreed to place all of those teachers that are off step onto the appropriate step where they belong. There is also an increase to the paraprofessionals of 35 cents an hour. And then for all the teachers who are on the appropriate step where they belong, a small stipend to help them for the first year of sort of bearing the burden of going to a lower cost health plan. It's actually a consumer-driven health plan. It is a higher deductible. It is a high deductible plan, I believe. And So a small stipend is given to the teachers who are already on the proper step to help them sort of absorb the burden of just the first year. I think there is one of the, slide is also on the back of the handout. And what we can see here at the top in blue is the salary. And you can see that between, let's see how far I can get.
This is this year.
The blue is this year. You can see it come down sharply into what is projected. And then the last slot on the line graph is with the collective bargaining agreement. So yes, you see the salary line shoot up a little bit. This is not an across-the-board salary increase for all the teachers. This is the way to get teachers who are now off step onto the proper step. The bottom line is healthcare costs. We have some savings in healthcare costs this year if we do nothing. We do have some savings. Why do we have some savings? Because there have been changes in staff. We are down a full teacher, a teacher resigned, and so we have those savings, and there are other savings that have taken place as well. But the important thing to see is that even with putting the teachers where they belong on the salary scale, we still have a savings in our salary line. And in health, we have even more savings in FY18 than we would have had without that. We've been talking along about reinvesting the savings that we find throughout Rollinsford Grade School back into the school. That doesn't mean just investing in the building, the physical building, it also means investing in our staff. And this is one way that we can reinvest some of that over $300,000 worth of savings back into the school to ensure ongoing excellent education that is provided.
All set? Mr. Crozier?
Wait, does anyone from the budget committee wish to make any comment? No.
Good morning, Bill Irving from the Budget Committee. Important, I think, to realize on the ballot when it goes out is this was a 5-5 vote. The Budget Committee voted not to recommend this. It was a tie 5-5. Personally, I do not understand the thought process of my colleagues that did not vote for this. I believe this is a no-brainer. It will save us money down the road. And I certainly would support it. I know a lot of people put a lot of stock into the recommendations of the Budget Committee. It was a 5-5 tie on this. Again, I don't understand why. It seems to be a no-brainer, and I would certainly recommend the community support it. Thank you,
Mr. Irving. The school district attorney informed me before the town meeting that this is one of the warrant articles that cannot be amended for a variety of legal reasons that I won't bore you with, but we can continue to discuss, debate, and request information on warrant article 6.
Hi, Rick Salvati, Upper Sligo Road, Rollinsford. Mr. Moderator. So I just wanted to clarify a couple of things. The REA offered this to the board on their own. Have they taken the decrease in the health insurance? That's true. And that the teacher increases are just bringing them where they're supposed to be because they were denied this in past years. I just want to, having said years past, and contentious debate over the teacher contract. I just want to commend the REA and teachers for this their part in making this budget work.
Thank you, Mr. Salvati. I find that debate on Article 6 is over. The article will be placed on the ballot. Article 7 relates to raising and appropriating money to repair or improve an ADA lift. And Mr. Robinson from the school committee will introduce the article.
Hello, everybody, again. So, everyone's back. So, Article 7 is for an automatic lift. $45,500. This is to replace the existing lift that we have in the main building on this side. So in the school, we call it the biggest lift because of how it has to work and the difficulty in the angle that it has to work at. So this is an ADA compliance. I believe that's the Americans with Disabilities Act. What we've tried to do with what we were saying earlier was we realized savings in Rollinsford Grade School by reducing the operating costs, and when we come to the town with warrant articles to improve the school, this is our first improvement that we'd like to suggest to the town this year, and that would be that we come into compliance with the ADA requirements and that we make sure that our lifts work for anyone who needs to use them. So. With that, this article is recommended by both the Budget Committee and the School Board, and I can show the full warrant and hand it back to Mr. Moderator. Okay,
thank you. And Budget Committee?
No comment.
All right. Article 7 is open for discussion, debate, and amendment.
In relation to all of the warrant articles that are above the operating budget, has the school board looked into any other financing sources such as grants or anything like that? I know on the town side they've looked into items like that.
Request for information regarding grant.
If there are grants available that we know of, we certainly do look for them before we go out to, before we place it on a warrant article. As far as we are aware, there are no grants available to help replace the lifts.
I find that debate on Article 7 is over. The article will be placed on the ballot. Article 8 relates to raising and appropriating money for connecting three-phase electrical power to the Rollinsford Grade School Annex. Again, I believe Mr. Robinson will introduce the article.
Hi, good morning again. So on the electrical side, I actually spoke about this a little bit ago. So this has been a three-piece setup for bringing three-phase power into this building. So we started by bringing three-phase power down the street into the building, and then we brought three-phase power into the building last year with a warrant article, and that brought it into the main part of the building. And now what we're proposing is an $80,000 warrant article that's going to bring three-phase power into the newer part of the building. And so this will complete the three-phase power transition that we've gone through for Rollinsford Grade School. And I'm not an electrician, but what we can say is, and other people can talk as well if they'd like, but three-phase power is what the majority of larger complexes have. And the reason that three-phase power was brought so highly on our list originally when we started this discussion is because three-phase power would be required for a building such as a fire station or as a police station. And when we started this process a couple of years ago, we were coming forward with a giant bond proposal where we were going to renovate the building and bring it up to all the standards that we wanted to. And when that decision was decided to be set aside for these smaller maintenance projects, you know, reducing the operating budget and increasing the warrant articles, like I've been repeating throughout the day, is that the three-phase power upgrade would be available if the town decided to do something different with this facility, with this building. So it would be a long-term investment that isn't just good for the school, but would also be good for other purposes as well. So with that being said, the article is recommended by both the Budget Committee and the School Board, and I'm going to hand it back to Mr. Kennedy.
Thank you very much, Mr. Robinson. And again, I assume that the Budget Committee is fine. We're open for discussion, debate, and amendment on warrant Article 8. I find the debate on warrant Article 8 is over. The article will be placed on the ballot. Article 9 relates to raising and appropriating money for the Educationally Disabled Children Capital Reserve Fund. And again, I think Mr. Robinson will introduce the article.
All right, good morning again. So this is a request that we have that has no tax impact to the town directly. And the reason being, what we ask the town to do is at the end of the year, this year, I'm actually going to make a quick adjustment here. I'm going to give you the values of these accounts. But what we ask the town to do is, if the school, the budget, school budget, has money left over, we ask the town to allow the school to put it into two different funds. Warrant Article 9 is for the Special Education Capital Reserve Fund. And what that fund allows us to do is build up a buffer of money in a fund that will allow us to come to the town to ask to remove that money in the case that we were to require it. And that's a kind of a mouthful. And what does all that mean? So the town is responsible to provide special education to all students and or all appropriately aged students, and that does go into young adults as well, no matter what the situation may be. Well, some of these cases can be very costly, in upwards of $100,000 to $200,000. So as you can see, when we run budgets that are very tight on numbers, and when we're reducing operating costs, and we're increasing our contractual obligations, right, it's very difficult to come up with a couple hundred thousand dollars if you have one student who requires it. And it also could be multiple students if there is an inflow of students who require services. So what we like to do is put this money aside, and today we have $130,160 in the account. Now, we're asking the town again for $25,000. For this account, if the money is left over at the end of the year. What I'd like to explain to the town is we're not going to ask for this every year. At some point, we are going to stop and say, okay, this fund is where we're comfortable with it. And just in the preliminary talks, we're thinking around $200,000. And that would allow the town, so once again, the money can't be used at the school's discretion or the school board's discretion. This would come back to the voters, and it would be a request to use the money into the funds in this account to cover a specific case that the Special Education Capital Reserve Fund legally can pay for. So with that, like I said, there's no tax impact. It just comes out of the budget at the end of the year if there's funds left over. So with that, we're going to do 10 separately.
We'll do 10 separately, yes. Thank you, Mr. Robinson. Discussion, debate, or amendment? Mr. Jansen.
One comment as a taxpayer, I would like to point out that it's not entirely correct what he says.
Jansen, do you mind coming up to the microphone?
Okay.
Just so we get the record, you're from Portland Avenue, right?
I'm from Portland Avenue for the last 45 years. My taxes have gone up most years. It's a small thing. And I'm an economist, and so he says it has no impact. I've seen it have an impact for the last 40 years. We used to put money into surplus money, so-called, for the current budget, it was returned to the taxpayers. And so in the next year, it will have an impact on the tax rate if that money was returned to the taxpayers. I'm not saying I'm against this. I'm just, as an economist, when people say it doesn't cost you anything, it does. You pay now, you pay later.
Thank you, Mr. Jansen. Further discussion, debate, request to amend, Mr. Salvati.
Mr. Salvati, 348 Sligo. Two questions on that. With such a tight budget, and we're actually decreasing the budget, do you anticipate any $25,000, or let alone $50,000? And if there is less than 25 or less than 50, which warrant article gets them? Is there a priority on the warrant articles, or is it split between them? Thank you.
Request some information from Mr. Salvati, Mr. Robinson.
Yes, so we actually have some decent information for you on this one. So first off, the anticipated savings that we would have. So this comes out of the FY17 budget. So that's this year's money. So we had a teacher resign early. Maybe not early. So we had a teacher resign. We didn't anticipate that, a change in staffing, until next year. So we do anticipate having a fund balance at the end of the year where this money would be allocated to these accounts. That being said, it allocates by Article 9 and 10. So if there's $25,000 available, it would go to the Special Education Fund first. If there's anything over that, it would go into the articles we'll discuss later on.
Special education in the prime time, that there are going to be long-term impacts financially and psychologically, emotionally for our children. We have to think what's beneficial for them, what's going to support them to be great citizens going forward. I know sometimes parents have to come up with costs for special education, and it's kind of expensive already to be a parent, so that's just my thought.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I find that the debate
Hi there, my name is Oz Actus. We moved here a year ago. We live in Pine Street. Just a comment on the gentleman before me. I'm a former economist, and the reason I left the field is one of the reasons is its inability and unwillingness to look at the human condition as a cost or gain. Although I think in the short run, the gentleman is right, it does save money to taxpayers, but when we don't spend this money now to help a kid who has special needs, when they grow up and when they don't have the skills that they need to be able to be a functioning member of the society, we'll pay more. So if we can keep that in mind as taxpayers, that'll be great.
Thank you. Thank you. Mrs. Putnam.
I feel like maybe people are misunderstanding this, because it's been my understanding in the past that this money is set aside so that if we have additional costs that we are required to pay for somebody with special education needs, that this money is then available to the town to use rather than not having it available, which by law we would be required to. So this is in fact a safety fund for us in the event that a student, for example, moves into town with special education needs that we have not formerly anticipated, and so therefore we have this increase, the amount of money that we need to come up with that we don't have a way to. So it's been my understanding that that is the point of this particular fund, so that this money is available in those instances. Could you just comment on that?
Okay, so a request for information about the nature of a reserve fund, Mr. Robinson.
So that was very well stated, and that is correct. So it's an emergency fund that we have set aside some money. So that way, if there is a situation that does require additional funds that the school does not have. Now, I'll say again, the school will have to exhaust all other funds before this can come to the town as an article to be voted on. So once the school exhaust their funds, the school can request that this come out for a road and request that we tap it for X number of dollars, whatever value that is. And so so there's a lot of discussion about, you know, savings versus however things, whether it's a savings now or paying later, had some economist chat. The way the school board looks at this account and the way that we're requesting, looking for the town to look at this account is, we would rather have an account set aside with funds in it. So if there is a situation that does arise that requires the school to reprogram money and to be able to afford to care for a special needs student, that we do not have to go to the town to have an emergency increase and have the town come up with money themselves, right? This would be a way for the school to be responsible, have an account set aside, so that way we can come to the town and say, town, we've exhausted our funds, we have this account, and we're debating around $200,000 that we can tap into to cover this need. Starting in the following year, it'll be in our budget, right? So it's really a one-time tap as an emergency type fund.
I find the debate is legal.
I'm sorry, but Mr. Robinson, you said you would have to exhaust all the other things, all the other lines in your budget before you tap into this. And I'm hoping that that doesn't affect the other kids, that you would take the excess in your budget and tap that out first. And my other concern is once we hit your target amount, that money stays in that account until it is used, and then we can rebuild it from there? Or does it at some point have to go back to the taxpayer?
Two questions for Ms. Leopold, Mr. Robinson, or Ms. Nelson.
Excellent questions. And yes, by exhausting all other funds, it means any non-contractual funds that we have, which means there would be a direct impact on Rollinsford Grade School, because that's the only place, as I keep telling you, I'm sure you're all tired of hearing me say it, but it's the only place where we as a town have any control over how our money is spent. And that is only items that are not already contracted with that affect Rollinsford Grade School. So so there would be an effect on other students, perhaps, although we hope not. That's the whole point of having the reserve fund. And yes, it stays until it is tapped, and then it is tapped, and then again, once we decide what a reasonable amount is to keep in there, we would probably try to build it back up if possible.
Thank you, Ms. Nelson. And I don't want to rush you, but I think the debate on Article 9 is over. The article will be placed on the ballot. Article 10 relates to raising and appropriating money for another capital reserve fund, the Rollinsford School Building Improvement Fund, and I think Mr. Robinson will introduce this article as well.
Good morning again. So Article 10 is the Building Capital Reserve Fund. So what I want to do is make sure that we don't confuse this with a capital improvement fund, because that's not what this is. This is a capital reserve fund that could be used for an emergency, and I want to throw in the word catastrophe in there as well, because this would be a major expense in a major situation to the school. So the follow-on conversation to that is doesn't the school have insurance? And yes, we do. But what we like to say about this account is this would help us with the insurance, right? So if an earthquake comes and or a giant sinkhole and swallows the school, right, insurance is going to help us with that. There's no question. We'll pay our deductibles and we'll move on. But there's going to be other expenses that are incurred that aren't going to be covered, right? We all know that from any sinkholes that have swallowed our houses, not or any other major catastrophe that comes out. So that being said, we're not looking at growing this account to be, a $500,000 so we can have this safety net. But we are looking at around $100,000, right? So, and possibly if the town is interested, we can debate that and we can bring it up higher. But today that account is at 78,000. So we're asking to put another 25,000 in there, which will cover us at about 100,000, which the school board feels comfortable would get us through a catastrophe in a major event. Once again, I'm going to say that no amount for this is raised through taxation of the FY18 timeframe. But as Mr. Jansen said, the money, if we don't put it in this account, would be sent back to the town and the tax rate, and changed around for tax rates. But that being said, on the ballot, it is a no tax impact warrant. With that, Mr. Moderator.
Thank you, Mr. Robinson. Is there discussion, debate, or amendments to be offered on Article 10? With that, I find the debate on Article 10 is over. The article will be placed on the ballot. Article 11 allows this meeting to transact any other business that may legally come before it. I recognize Judy Nelson, who has a matter to bring before the legislative body.
Thank you all. I won't take too long. There are just a few other items. I'm standing up on my tiptoes because I don't want to. I hope you all can hear me. So a couple items of business to end things here today. As many of you know, the SAU 56 board, of which the Rollinsford School Board is a part, has accepted a letter of retirement from Superintendent of Schools Jenny Mosca. This is her last Rollinsford School District deliberative session. Congratulations, Superintendent Mosca. Absolutely. Her retirement will start on July 1st. So why am I telling you about this right now? I'm telling you about it because while I would love to wax a little bit poetic about Superintendent Mosca, I will save that for another time, and in the interest of time here, I'll save that time. But the school board, the SAU board, and the Rollinsford School Board is now entering into a superintendent search. And we would like input from as many people in town as quickly as we can get it, because we are moving very quickly to try to find a replacement. Unless you're interested, I also will not run through the steps of how the search is proceeding, but I will tell you how you can help get information to us. Sitting from on the Rollinsford side, we are, let me just say again, the SAU School Board is made up of Somersworth and Rollinsford. We are pretty much, we are equal partners with Somersworth in this search. Each board has two board members on it. In this case, I am sitting on the search committee, and so is Tom Coons. So either of us can be reached by email to give us comments. What we are looking for are traits and values. They can be one word, they can be a short sentence. Traits and values that you would like to see in a superintendent of schools. Conversely, traits or values you do not want to see in a superintendent of schools can also be shared with us, because we are going to start building a leadership profile, a superintendent profile, that we will then be looking for our new applicants to fill. So you can email either Tom or myself, and our email addresses are on the handout that were there. They're also online. You can come next Thursday on the 9th, right here, before the Rollinsford School Board meeting. I will be here 45 minutes early, and I will talk to anyone in person who would like to come and share their traits and values with me, or just talk about superintendency in general. And if you want to just attend the whole meeting, you can also make a closing comment. I'll stick around afterwards too to listen to those. On Monday around noon, if I don't get around to it earlier, these little boards are going to go up asking you, you can just go and write a comment down. There'll be one at the town hall, one at the library, one at the post office, and one here at the school. Just feel free to write down a trait or a value that you would like to see in your superintendent of schools. and they will be picked up again by noon on the 15th, because the 15th is the first organizational meeting that we're going to be having on this. So anyway, as much help as any of you can give us, that would be great. Very much appreciated. One last order of business. We still have some empty candidate slots. So we didn't get all of our candidate slots filled, and sometimes this happens. If people who will run for office. Coming up at the March election, we have two seats for school board. We have one candidate who has signed up, a returning member, we hope, I guess, because you know she's already put some time in. Andrea Anderson has signed up to run for another term. Alan Robinson will be leaving the school board due to other obligations, family and work obligations. You'll see his name elsewhere on the town ballot. But we have one open school board seat. Open, meaning no one's running for it. We have the open clerk position. Anyone who's interested might want to talk to Corey over there, who stepped up and did the job this time for us, but it would be nice to have someone step up. And we also have the moderator position still open. Moderator Putnam what we like is people to step up so that we can tell people who to write in. If you have an interest, we would like to tell them who to write in so it doesn't just go crazy and one person gets one vote, one person gets three votes, and that kind of thing. A moderator Putnam is interested in returning.
Yes.
As the school board moderator. So you heard it here first. Please write in Charlie Putnam for that position. With that, I am ready to let you all go. I appreciate very much everybody's turnout today. Hope to see everyone, and please bring about 10 friends to the March election. Thank you.
Thank you all for your attendance here today. I give your opinion during the deliberations, and I appreciate that. I want to thank Judy Nelson, Vern Crozier, Chief Ducharme, for their assistance and preparing for this meeting. And thank you all of you for taking time out of your meeting. I'll take a motion to adjourn.
Motion to adjourn.
Seconded. Those in favor of adjourn, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Thank you all very
much. Thank you.
No, you can't hear me.
Nice job. Be careful.